to begin by acknowledging that we meet tonight on the traditional lands of the Kaurna people. We acknowledge their ancestors, we acknowledge the present members of that community, and we also acknowledge that their connection and responsibility for the land has never gone away, and it will be, it's been in the past, it's in the present, and it will be in the future. But we're also going to be talking about other Aboriginal land in South Australia, and perhaps like me, you were horrified to read the front page of the Advertiser some time ago, where the White Shoe Brigade came out saying, yeah, nuclear waste dump, Maralinga would be a good spot. And I'm thinking, how insensitive can you be in terms of all that that community has put up with over the last half century? But anyway, we're going to be talking about areas of South Australia that are also Aboriginal land. We're going to be hearing a bit more about that from Karina Lester later on, so you're very welcome, Karina. Thank you for coming. I'd like to acknowledge all of our special guests. I'll be introducing the speakers as we go along, but a special welcome to Ian Lowe, who's not quite a boat person. How would you describe Ian? He lives in Queensland and he lives in South Australia. He's a transient, he's an itinerant. Professor Ian Lowe, and I'll introduce him more later, but you're very welcome, Ian. And Senator Scott Ludlam, who's come over from Western Australia. And also on the set speakers list, Craig Wilkins, CEO of the Conservation Council. But we've also got other members of Parliament who've come tonight, and that's fantastic. And I particularly acknowledge my parliamentary colleague, the Honourable Tammy Franks, MLC, and my federal parliamentary colleague, Senator Penny Wright, a Green Senator for South Australia, and a particular welcome also to Steph Key, the ALP member for Ashford, and it's really good to have you here today, Steph, and the stuff we're talking about today, all members of Parliament are going to have to get their heads around, because this is a critical issue for our state. So in terms of the topic and the format for tonight, the topic, you know, it's up there on the screen, South Australia, the nuclear state, why it makes no sense. Now, Professor Ian Lowe did suggest that not only does it not make sense, but it doesn't make any dollars either, and so we might, it's pretty odd, it's a good line, but it didn't make the cut then, it didn't get into the title, but we did take it seriously, we workshopped it. Doesn't make sense, doesn't make dollars either. I'll also say that a number of people contacted me and said, Mark, this is so unbalanced. You know, why aren't you providing equal time at your forum for the pro-nuclear industry? To which my response was, that's what the Advertiser's for. That's what the big end of town has been doing ad nauseum. So this is an opportunity for you to hear from experts arguments that you're not going to get from the mainstream media. And if there's any indication of the lack of interest of the mainstream media, none of them turned up today when we had the press conference to talk about launching this event tonight and launching a campaign statewide anti-nuclear. Quite depressing. So anyway, we know what we're up against. It's a one-paper town, and we're going to have to work hard to build a community around this issue. And we cannot rely on the Advertiser, and we can't rely on commercial media, so we're going to have to do it ourselves. Now, the four speakers you now have before you, well, you haven't got them before you yet because I told them to sit in the front, but they will soon be sitting before you. Now, they're all people who we could actually give exclusive billing to and listen to them all night. But not unfortunately, we've got a couple of constraints. Constraint number one is we're going to finish at 9 o'clock. Right? That's a good hour and a half, is a good amount of time for us to concentrate and stay focused. The other thing is we want to leave as much time as possible for questions and discussion from the floor. And so that means we are necessarily going to sort of, I am going to be a bit brutal, dinging the glass when it's time. So the speakers I know will respect that, but I want to give you as much time as possible to answer questions. One other thing. There are plenty of copies out the front of this booklet, which I know Scott's had a bit to do with. It's called Let the Facts Speak. But Scott wasn't the original author. I think this booklet, in its first incarnation, was 20 or 30 years ago. And it was a running tally of all of the things that have gone wrong with the nuclear industry. And every few years, it gets revised, and they add new things to it. They added Chernobyl, and they added Fukushima. So these are free. They're out the front. And grab a copy as you leave if you haven't seen it. Otherwise, Google it. You can get it online as well. Now, I think that's right for housekeeping. I'm looking for a nod from the boss. Yep. Okay. Our first speaker tonight is Professor Ian Lowe. Now, I'm going to read you a little bit of a bio from Ian. He studied electrical engineering and physics at the University of New South Wales. He then obtained his doctorate in physics from the University of York, supported by the UK Atomic Energy Authority. He lectured at the UK Open University and Griffith University, at which he is still Emeritus Professor of Science, Technology and Society. Ian directed the Commission for the Future in 1988. He chaired the Advisory Council, which produced the first national report on the state of the environment in 1996. And he was president of the Australian Conservation Foundation from 2004 to 2014. That's where I first got to know Ian. He's a fellow of the Academy of Technological Sciences and Engineering. He's published extensively on energy issues and has received very many awards for his work. He will probably explain this to you himself, but he is soft of voice tonight, but he's going to do his very best. And you please give him a very warm welcome to Professor Ian.
Thanks, Mark. I'll try to speak as close to the microphone as I can because I've come back from a cricket tour with a very heavy cold and I don't have much voice. The topic is there a role for the nuclear industry in South Australia? The answer is no. Are there any questions? I think that was a bit glib and superficial, so I'll expand on that just a little bit. I'd also like to acknowledge that we're on the land of the Kaurna people and remind you of the significance of that in the context of this discussion, because the original Australians worked out over tens of thousands of years that for societies to endure, they need custom and practice and a system of law that allows them to live in balance with natural systems to develop sustainably. I also wanted to remind you that the future is not somewhere we're going, it's something we're creating. At any given time, there are a wide range of possible futures. And I think it's obvious that from that range of futures, we should be trying to shape one that is at least in principle sustainable. Now, put your hand up if you know that Australia has a national strategy for ecologically sustainable development. Yes, I thought that might be the response. I was going to say, put your hand up if you read it, but you see little sign, although it was adopted by COAG in 1992, you see little sign that our Commonwealth government or any of the state governments show any sign that they have read the National Strategy for Ecologically Sustainable Development or recognise that it was adopted by COAG and is meant to be the basis on which we develop. That we have a path of economic progress that does not impair the welfare of future generations. That we believe there should be equity within and between generations. That we recognise the global dimension, things like global issues like climate change perhaps, and that our pattern of development has as its fundamental core the protection of biological diversity and the maintenance of ecological processes and systems. And the fundamental problem of nuclear technology is that it's a decisive step away from the principle of sustainable development. It's based on centralized power rather than decentralization, large inflexible units rather than small local flexible ones. It produces radioactive waste, which is a massive enduring problem, a problem that at the moment endures orders of magnitude in time longer than any human society has ever endured. It provides a fissile material which can be used to make nuclear weapons, and it increases the power of elites, which we know from all our experience will use it irresponsibly. You may have seen some recent claims in the what passes for a daily newspaper in this state, that nuclear will give us cheap, clean power, which will kickstart the economy. One of your more gullible senators even said that it would provide free electricity and so much extra revenue you'd be able to abolish state taxes. I had a sense of deja vu. It's not since the 1960s, the height of nuclear optimism, that people were saying that the power would be so cheap they would give it away and not bother to meter it. But even those demented technocrats never said it would be so cheap you'd be able to abolish state taxes as well. Senator Sean Edwards has set a new benchmark for gullibility. They also suggested that radioactive waste, not just from the rest of Australia might be located here, but from the rest of the world, and expect you to believe this will be an economic bonanza. Now, it may be true that societies like the US and the UK will eventually give up on trying to persuade any of their communities to host their radioactive waste and look around for someone more gullible. But all you can say at this stage is that that is an unsubstantiated assertion, and the idea that they are already willing to write checks that will make South Australia the Saudi Arabia of the Southern Hemisphere just to get rid of their radioactive waste, and you will be happy to accept that deal, is at best unproven. And the final bit of barefaced cheek is portraying nuclear power as a solution to climate change. Now let me run this by you. We have a federal government that is so unconcerned about climate change that it's happy to expand the exports of coal, which already produce far more greenhouse gases than we do as an entire nation, is happy to curb the renewable energy target, is happy to abolish the price on carbon, but at the same time says climate change is such an urgent problem, we should be panicked into building nuclear reactors. Call me a cynic if you like, but I can't see any logical consistency in that policy set. There are obvious public concerns that nuclear power is too expensive, too slow, makes too little difference, has operating risks, produces radioactive waste, and can lead to weapons proliferation. And if you think that it's only left-wing academics and greeny activists who make that sort of case, John Howard set up the Switkowski Committee to make the case for Australia going nuclear. The membership was thoroughly stacked, chaired by the chairman of the Australian Nuclear Science and Technology Organisation. The members were, to a man, and I use the gender-specific word advisedly, either actively or covertly pro-nuclear. But you can only bend the facts so far, and their report said nuclear would cost 20 to 50% more than other forms of generating electricity, including wind. 15 years would be a realistic timescale for building one nuclear power station, one, that even if we went hell for leather and built 25 nuclear reactors between now and 2050, that would only reduce the growth in our greenhouse gas emissions by 18%. So as a solution to climate change, that is distinctly underwhelming. They said tactfully that waste, quote, remains an issue, end of quote, which means that there is no solution to it at the moment. The economics of enrichment are problematic, and I reminded someone the other day that Dr. Alan Roberts famously said that wherever uranium is enriched, taxpayers are impoverished, because it's not a commercially successful operation anywhere. It always operates with government subsidies. And those conclusions from an overtly pro-nuclear group suggest that the public concerns are indeed well-founded. Another commercial report, the AMP Capital Investors 2004, said there are significant concerns about whether an acceptable waste disposal solution exists. From a sustainability perspective, while the nuclear waste issues remain unresolved, the uranium and nuclear power industry is transferring the risks, cost and responsibility to future generations. Radioactive waste from nuclear power stations needs to be stored for something like 240,000 years, 10 times the half-life of plutonium-239. And it's an obvious point that that is far longer than any human society has ever endured. So you're not just talking about a huge technological challenge, you're also talking about a huge social challenge. Those who support nuclear energy do a discounted cash flow calculation and say that the cost is trivial, because any cost incurred 30 or 50 or 100 years away, discounted to present day values, is essentially zero. But it will still be a real cost to all future generations, not just for a few decades, but for hundreds of thousands of years. In terms of direct risk to communities, we had the Three Mile Island accident, that we were told that even though the reactor was destroyed, no radioactivity was released, and so it wasn't a risk to the community. Then we had Chernobyl, where large amounts of radioactivity were spread around Eastern and Western Europe, but we were told not to worry because that was a primitive Eastern European design, and that couldn't possibly happen in a civilized Western society. Then we had Fukushima, and there is a large area around there which is still a no-go zone. Something like 25,000 people are still displaced, and the cost of the cleanup was recently estimated by the Japan Times at $167 billion. Just to put that in perspective, that's about five times what it would cost to convert Australia totally to renewable energy in perpetuity, the cost of cleaning up one accident. And I remind you that the nuclear industry is essentially uninsurable, so that the costs of cleaning up are a cost to the community, a cost to the taxpayer. So why wouldn't people be concerned? Well, we're told that Fukushima was in an area that's known for earthquakes, so we'd be confident that nothing like that could happen anywhere near we live. I might have believed that 5 years ago, but 4 years ago I was sitting in this coffee shop in High Street, Christchurch, having ordered a toasted panini and a flat white, not aware that I was in a situation of any peril, because Christchurch was not a known place for earthquakes. That is what the coffee culture building looks like today. It's a reminder that we are still cosmically ignorant about the complexity of the natural systems of the Earth, and there is nowhere we can build something as concerning as a nuclear power station and say with assurance that it is safe in perpetuity. Even China, which is seen as the flagship of nuclear generation globally, says a bright future for nuclear power, yes, but without proper safeguards, the bright future will be overshadowed by dark clouds or even ruined by disasters. And that's the fundamental point, that nuclear power carries with it the risk of disasters or terrorist action. No one worries about a terrorist getting hold of a wind turbine blade or a solar panel, but people do justifiably worry about terrorists getting hold of fissile material. There is always, of course, the promise of better technology. And I've been hearing the promise of better technology for as long as I've been around the physics of nuclear energy, which is longer than I would care to admit. We have constantly been told that the next generation of reactors will be cheaper and cleaner and safer and not have the problems of the existing reactors. Now, just because people have been consistently wrong for 50 years doesn't mean they'll always be wrong, but it does mean you should take their assurances with a very large grain of salt. We are told that Generation 4 reactors will solve the problems, but these have not yet even been built anywhere else. The Sutkowski Committee said the economics might look promising if the Generation 4 reactors were built and successive generations of them were built, and we were a late adopter of this new technology. But there's a fundamental problem there. If nuclear power is an urgent response to climate change, we can't be a late adopter of reactors that aren't even built yet. But if we adopt the reactors that are around now, it doesn't make any economic sense. Fast breeder reactors have been around again since the 60s. Indeed, the group at the UK Atomic Energy Authority that sponsored my research were working on the prototype fast breeder reactor at Dounreay in Scotland. The UK and the US have now given up on fast breeder reactors because the technology is just too complex. But even if they were successful and were built, that would introduce a whole new range of problems. A conventional reactor can explode and spread a bit of radioactive material around, but a fast breeder reactor could, in principle, explode catastrophically. It could produce a nuclear explosion rather than a conventional steam explosion or a hydrogen explosion. And even if there was never an accident in a fast breeder reactor, generations of fast breeder reactors enough to make a difference would put in flow around the planet an amount of plutonium that dwarfs the current total weapons inventory. One calculation that if we could build enough breeder reactors to reduce by 25% our greenhouse gas emissions, that would put in circulation annually an amount of plutonium about 100 times the current total weapons inventory. To think that could be done without risk is naive in the extreme. People talk about thorium reactors and fusion reactors. These are again still gleams in the eyes of technocrats. When I was an honours student in physics 50 years ago, the professor of theoretical physics said, a rather lame joke, but then physicists are given to rather lame jokes, commercial fusion power is about 50 years away and probably always will be. Today, 50 years later, there are optimists who say commercial fusion power is only 50 years away, but you wouldn't want to be hanging on by your fingernails waiting for it. Final point I want to make is that the real community concerns about the nuclear industry, the community concerns that have been there ever since the 1960s, will not be allayed by bald assertions. And they will not be allayed by people with technocratic values assuring us that we have nothing to worry about. Both cost curves and community attitudes favour renewables. And the fundamental point is, if renewables can meet our needs, and there are serious engineering studies that show that they can, at not much more cost than business as usual, why in the name of all that's holy and wonderful would we want to use nuclear power? Thank you very much.
Well, thanks very much, Ian. That was great. I had to confess to Ian when I saw him last that I've been stealing his lines in my speeches for years, one of which was that, you know, the sustainable future has hot showers and cold beer, but we're just going to provide those services in a different way because we don't want to frighten people. And then Ian confessed that he'd actually stolen that from an American ecologist. So, and you can see why. He's a great science communicator. So thank you, Ian. Our next speaker is Senator Scott Ludlam. And Scott was elected to the Senate in November 2007, and again, thank goodness, in April 2014, at the famous first ever Senate by-election in Western Australia. Scott is currently one of 11 Australian Greens members in the Federal Parliament. In a previous life, Scott was a graphic designer, an environmental and social justice campaigner, and a political advisor at both state and federal level. Scott is a long-time campaigner against the nuclear cycle and has worked tirelessly to end nuclear weapons and nuclear power. Among other things, he has probed radiation leaks and water contamination at the Range uranium mine in the Northern Territory, highlighted the ongoing radiation safety concerns at Australia's only nuclear facility at Lucas Heights, and worked with the community to successfully oppose the government's proposed National Radioactive Waste Dump at Muckaty Station in the Northern Territory. Please welcome Scott Ludlam.
Can you hear me okay? I feel totally redundant. I think Ian has smashed it out of the park so hard, I'm not even sure I need to do this, to be honest. That was great. And to my mind, the first thing it made me think of is how long this debate has been going for and how much we have run the arguments and how much the arguments remain invariant. Like, I don't know how many times you feel you've given that presentation or presentations like it over the last however long. But the fact is, we're still here. We still have to run the argument. That's one of the reasons that I'm really glad to be here, because I have no idea what your Premier is up to with this Royal Commission thing. It seems a bit crazy, and there's some elements of it that deeply don't add up. So I'm going to get through my stuff fairly quickly, because Ian has done it way better than me, and then go to the Q&A, and maybe you can help me figure out exactly what these people are up to. I also want to acknowledge the traditional owners of this country, the Kaurna, who have been here for at least 200 times the age of the city, and also acknowledge that Aboriginal people, having been forced in some instances off their land by pastoralism, by mining in this state and in the northwest of my home state of Western Australia, were forced off country by nuclear weapons explosions, were actually attacked by nuclear weapons by an ally. And that here and in Australia and around the world, it is actually Aboriginal communities who have copped the brunt of this industry, which, whether it be at the mining end, the weapons testing end, or almost inevitably the waste dumping end, a lot of the time it's Aboriginal communities and populations who've really copped the hard edge of this industry. One person I'd like to acknowledge, probably won't thank me for it, but they give me a microphone so I'm going to do it anyway, is David Noonan, who is such a long time candidate. Organiser and researcher for the Australian Conservation Foundation for years, and I feel like collectively we owe him a debt for the depth of wisdom and commitment to this cause, as well as I understand many other people in the audience. I come from Fremantle, that's my home port, and spent a chunk of yesterday up in Port Adelaide with Kat Leedon and some of the crew who are organising there around, again, the frontline impacts. So they took us to the outer harbour where we didn't see a shipment, which is probably just as well, where the yellow cake is bound for enrichment plants on the other side of the world, and where potentially we might see imports of the waste products of this industry if certain people get their way. When I say that something deeply doesn't add up about this Royal Commission, I really mean it. There's something very, very strange going on. The first thing being they excluded mining, as far as I'm aware, from the terms of reference. So we're here to talk about the nuclear industry. Don't talk about the bit that actually exists, though. Don't whatever you do, investigate what BHP is up to at Roxby. And you remember, the last time the Australian Senate conducted an inquiry into the impacts of uranium mining, which found, among other things, who left it behind? Is it too quiet? Is it better?
Yeah,
sorry, the mic is very low. And I've totally lost my train of thought, and it's because that person's phone rang. So I think it was 2003, there was a Senate inquiry into uranium mining. One of the recommendations, or one of the things that they found, was that there was a pattern of underperformance and non-compliance. But guess what? BHP got Roxby excluded from the terms of reference. Go and look at uranium mining everywhere else. But I'm well aware, coming from a state where no commercial uranium mine has ever gone into production, just how powerful that corporation is in this state and how much they own the politics and have actually poisoned public debate, not just on uranium mining, obviously, but on what happens to that stuff, what happens to the oxide when it leaves the port, where it goes and what it contributes to. The fact of the matter is, one of the things it contributes to is all three of the reactors that melted down and then melted through in Tohoku on Japan's Pacific coast on 311 contained fuel from Australian uranium mines, so from here in Kakadu. That is one of the consequences, that the cesium that boiled into the ocean and God knows what else that got out, basically broken uranium atoms from Kakadu and central South Australia. And that is one of the things that is actually most heartbreaking, is talking to the Aboriginal mobs who are responsible for that country, who said at the outset, don't mine it, don't mine it, don't mine it. All of our stories about protection and leaving that stuff where it is, not disturbing what lies under the ground, were then made to feel responsible for the catastrophe that unfolded on the other side of the world. So excluding mining is a shame. I can't remember the exact numbers, but if that expansion of Roxby goes ahead, if they actually manage to open cut that thing and pull that material out, one of the lowest grade but by far the largest uranium deposit on the face of the planet that's known to geologists anywhere, you're going to end up with something in the order of more than a cubic kilometer, if you can visualize a cubic kilometer of very finely pulverized and powdered radioactive tailings sitting on the surface. Stuff is carcinogenic, means it gives you cancer if you're exposed to it. And it's going to be sitting there, at least in Kakadu, they have the good grace to put the garbage back into the hole and cap it, where it won't stay. It'll get into the groundwater, it'll move around. But at least they have the good grace to get it off the surface. And of course, BHP has bought itself a free pass. A royal commission into who the hell allowed that to happen, that's something that I could get behind. But there you go, it's been excluded. So mining's out. I think Ian has quite successfully demolished the case, even if you're not interested in safety. Even if you are not interested in this timeless legacy of poisonous waste that's still going to be ticking 200,000 years from now, the global financial community has well and truly made up its mind. No deregulated energy market anywhere in the world, i.e. where private investors and private capital is given the opportunity to decide what the energy mix is, and there's real problems with that, but nonetheless, in none of those markets anywhere around the world has anybody actually put up their own money to build a nuclear power station. It exists as a creature and a parasite of massive state subsidies, whether it's North America, Japan, Western Europe, China, India, take your pick. Markets already made up their mind. You can turn a $1 billion asset into $500 billion liability in about half an hour. And that was what they realised right after Three Mile Island, and then Wall Street walked away and said, there's actually not enough loan guarantees in the world. You could not structure a financial deal good enough for us to want to put our own money into these things. And that's why they basically stopped building them. So nobody is going, I'm sorry, Senator Edwards, if you're in the room, nobody is going to build a nuclear power station in South Australia, partly because it would break your grid. You know, nobody can drop a gigawatt of nuclear energy. Inflexible, you just turn it up to 10 and then walk away. Totally inflexible, plays very poorly with variable wind and solar generators. Like, nobody's going to come along and build one of them, I'm sorry. And if they did, it would be a catastrophic impact on state finances, and we all collectively end up paying for that. The enrichment market is hopelessly glutted. Even if it did make a profit, forget it. The projections that the industry was making for itself in the 60s, 70s, 80s, and 90s never came to pass, so the enrichment capacity of the global nuclear fuel chain is well and truly glutted. It's over capacity. So nobody's going to come along and build one of those. I think Ian quite successfully demolished the case. The fast reactor, or a gentleman asked me at an event prior about the prism reactor, that is small, cheap, modular. Cheap, did I mention that? is, you know, proliferation proof, cheap, and consumes only nuclear waste and emits only unicorn dust. It doesn't exist, and it's not going to exist. And if you take a step back and ask yourself, what actually is the task here? The task here is to spin an electromagnet. Or it might just be to heat water up for a hot shower. But the central task, actually, if you're into shunting electrons down wires, is to spin an electromagnet. That's your ultimate engineering objective. What's the cheapest and most elegant and reliable way you can spin the electromagnet? Actually, it's not refined plutonium cooking inside some kind of liquid sodium coolant system that catches fire if it makes contact with air or water. It's a ridiculous way to boil water. So, and one of the reasons that nobody, apart from a very small handful of centrally planned energy markets, are building nuclear power stations, is that it's been quite seriously torn to pieces by fast, flexible, and very rapid and cheaply deployed clean energy technologies. And it's just as well. Like, we don't have to make that stuff up. If you're not sure, and if you came along tonight, and I don't assume that everybody here has come along with your mind made up, and I think that would be a very dangerous assumption, let's assume that there's healthy skepticism in the room, is to read a thing, or at least scan a thing, called the World Nuclear Status Report. And they produce it, it's a guy called Michael Schneider. They produce it once a year, and it's effectively just a pretty stripped back data set that tells you about the world's nuclear reactor fleet. Who has built them? How old are they? What's the average retirement age? What's the average operating age? What are the costs? What are the economics? Market by market, reactor by reactor. And you can read that document, I would argue, and still come out pro-nuclear. The basis of the report is neither pro nor anti, but we could at least have the debate on a basis of agreed facts. And the conclusions you draw, I'm totally cool with the conclusions, but we should at least start with the basic facts of the industry. My reading of it being, it's buggered. It's actually on its knees. China, even the Chinese, who are the only ones who you would say actually have the competence to stamp them out reasonably rapidly on the timescales that they're saying they will, got a glut of plutonium and cesium because Japan actually is not that far from the Chinese mainland on 311, put their entire build schedule on hold while they went, actually, do we really want to do this? Are we sure we want to do this? I hadn't seen that quote by the president before. So they're building them. But actually, a lot of the rest of the progress that the industry claims is not progress at all. There are a lot of people there out there in second thoughts. So if it's not about mining, it's not about enrichment, it's not about these new fast breeder reactors that aren't going to exist in the time scale that we need them to, and it's probably just as well. It's not about conventional generation 3 or 3 plus reactors. Then what's it about? What's left? It's probably about waste. You're probably being softened up for a waste dump. And we know from the extraordinary struggle of the Kungas that radioactive waste unites people, not in a way that the industry hopes it does, but it unites people. When those old women stood up, in the early 2000s and said, it might look like a blank space on the map to you, but it isn't. when the Mukkiri elders, again, largely led by strong women, stood up and said, this might look terra nullius from Canberra or Sydney. It's not, we've lived here forever. And by the way, if it's not safe to live in Sydney or on the outskirts of Indian Point or in California, then how is it suddenly made safe by putting in a shipping container and dropping it off on a cattle station outside Tennant Creek? So it's probably about waste. And the weird thing, and this is what I mean about things not necessarily adding up very well, is that it's completely out of sync with McFarlane's, with Industry Minister Ian McFarlane's timetable for a national radioactive waste dump. Because they are opening expressions of interest now, and they're closing that, I think, at the end of April. It's quite soon. There is no way your Royal Commission is going to have anything on the table in time to make a meaningful submission to a national site selection process. And it's what McFarlane's doing, actually, and we should pay credit to it, is actually really different to what previous Australian governments have done and just said, you know, where's a black fella who could use $12 million? All right, it's you, and we're just going to try and ram it and force it through. They've said it's going to be voluntary, it's going to be a bit open. It's not what we needed as a process, but it's certainly a lot better than what we had. But whatever it is that Weatherall's up to doesn't appear to be synced in with that, because the timeline's too far out of sync. So that is why the concern, when you kind of scratch through the things that it's clearly not about, actually all that is left is international waste. And the possibility that not necessarily the United States, not necessarily the Russian, you know, the Russian government, but maybe Taiwan, maybe South Korea, maybe countries with small nuclear programs, relatively small, maybe Belgium, and absolutely no idea what to do with their spent fuel. And that was what the Pangaea proposal was that landed in WA in 1999. And that, again, from a guy sitting at a computer workstation in Geneva or London, looks at WA and says, it's a blank space. And then when you get out there to Cosmo Newbury, the mob are there like, well, we have actually been here for 40,000 years. Mm. Maybe you don't know the names. Maybe they don't appear on your maps. They certainly appear in ours. And one of the things, one of the big favours that Pangaea did was produce this video that got leaked to Friends of the Earth in London in 99. Way before they were ready, way before Pangaea actually had its ducks lined up and had all the right conversations and had got everybody on the same page politically. And this video, which is still available online, it's actually really worth a look if you can find it. Look up Pangaea promotional video, it's still drifting around out there. You get about halfway through the video and it suddenly makes sense and they explain it to you. Why is it that wherever you go in the world, anybody, the handful of countries, the 30-odd, 35-odd countries that have had an active nuclear program, when they go looking for somewhere to put the waste, they look for empty land, they look for stable geology, they look for very low, deep groundwater that's not moving around very much. They look for an area with no recent history of seismic activity. They look for, you know, a long way from people. Why is it that those are the kind of sites they chase? And the Pangaea video actually tells you, it's one of the places I've seen that story told honestly. And the little video shows a radioactive waste caster, these precision engineered structures for holding this toxic garbage in, and it shows it leaking and the material bleeding out. And the fact being, there is no form of engineered containment that this stuff won't burn its way out of. There is nothing has yet been invented that will hold this stuff in, certainly not for a quarter of a million years, but actually not for a quarter of a century yet. It doesn't exist yet. And so the video basically says, that's why we're coming looking for the blank spaces on the map, because when it burns its way out of the engineered containment, we want it to be a long way from people. And that closes the argument as far as I'm concerned. For all the people out there proposing that maybe nuclear waste is a great idea, if you can't guarantee you can contain that stuff, you have no business dumping it, particularly not on Aboriginal people. You have no business dumping that stuff until you can show how you can actually look after it and contain it. And if you can do that, you probably don't need the remote high isolation site. And that, to me, actually closes the argument about remote radioactive waste dumps. There's one more thing. Poor old Senator Edwards is copping a bit of a flogging tonight. He's not here to defend himself. But I would ask again, if you'd be in contact with people who think, nonetheless, it's a good idea for a state that has had the Roxby expansion cut out from underneath it, has naval shipbuilding in a great measure of uncertainty, and has seen the collapse of skilled manufacturing in the car industry, looking for a stable source of revenue. And I think it's entirely reasonable, whatever your politics are, to be looking around for, well, what the hell comes next? What's the skilled employment base for the state? But the fact is it's not going to be the nuclear industry. And one of the key reasons around waste is there appear to be two lines of argument. One of them being this stuff is a precious resource, spent fuel. It's full of plutonium. It's full of fissile uranium. You could reprocess it, get that stuff out. That's a wealth of stuff. That is an incredible resource that we could value add. And on the other hand, the other side of the argument is, and we could make billions of dollars in foreign exchange from people paying us to take it away. And I just think, you've got to pick one. People don't pay you to take away valuable stuff. So pick one. And actually, this stuff is garbage. There is never going to be a closed nuclear fuel chain that has reprocessing on an organised industrial scale, and it's just as well that there's not. But I would say, from the little bit that I know about the fact that this is already the country's leader, this state is already the nation's leader in renewable energy technology, is get some of that big solar thermal stuff into you. All of the manufacturing is local. It's not like a wind turbine that you plant in the ground and walk away. All the welding needs to be done really close to site, and the stuff keeps blue collar workers busy for years. And then you need 40 or 50 people to operate one of those things. And that can fill in the peaks and the troughs of demand once you've brought in all of the cheap PV and wind energy. This state could be 100% renewable well within a generation. That is how it works.
For keeping your tie on. Scott and Senator Wright and I met with the Property Council today. We thought the ties were good ideas. I've got my tie on still. Anyway, our next speaker is Craig Wilkins. And Craig is a community activist with over 25 years' experience in a variety of community campaigns. After dropping out of an economics degree, he worked as a community health nurse in Australia, India and West Africa. He's worked on energy poverty with the South Australian Council of Social Services, on community food systems, and active transport within the South Australian State Government Office of Sustainability. And he's also worked for a variety of community causes, which he describes as some lost, some found. The overwhelming highlight of his career was 7 years spent working for Mark Parnell in Australia. I made that bit up. he worked in my office for 7 years, thank you, Craig. And I hope that wasn't a lost cause. But for the last 18 months, Craig has been the chief executive of the state's peak environment body, the Conservation Council of South Australia. He's a passionate believer in collective altruism, the act of people generously working together on behalf of others and the planet that we call home. Please welcome Craig Wilkins.
Thanks so much, Mark. You're in for a real treat tonight, and you've already seen it. I mean, you've got three of the most articulate and insightful commentators on this issue in Australia. Incredibly hard acts to follow, the first two, and Karina is a real treat, so you are blessed. My job is to give a bit of local context and to talk about what's next, and also, I think, to provide some humour. And so for me to talk about nuclear, I had to appeal to the highest authority, the most comprehensive and credible authority, and that's The Simpsons. For those of you who don't know, The Simpsons are based in a town called Springfield, and looming over the town of Springfield is the Springfield nuclear power plant. And over the sort of 20 odd years that Simpsons have been running, they have gone through so many different themes that have been picked up by Ian and Scott already around corporate control, shortcuts and human errors causing meltdowns, environmental concerns, lots of spin. And like any good satire, they are incredibly close to reality. But it was when the Royal Commission was announced, another episode jumped out for me. Because at times over the last few weeks, ever since the Royal Commission was announced, as someone who's been in the media sort of commenting about it, it's felt like a bit of a stampede, that I'm standing in between a mob of footy players at the end of season trip and a keg of beer with a sign saying, drink me and make yourself more attractive and smarter. It's just been this rush of people going, rushing towards it. But it's weird because I don't think we actually want to take in the toxic waste. As Scott says, that's the real game. Do we really want to do that? Is that a thing by choice? So instead, my sense is that this is driven by fear. And the two biggest factors around this fear, one is around the fear of climate change, and that is a legitimate fear to have. And the second one, as Scott also alluded to, it's the fear of becoming an economic backwater. And that seems to be driving a lot of the political conversation. So, driven by fear, we want to believe that nuclear is the solution. And when you want to believe something, you're susceptible to the monorail effect. And this is where The Simpsons can be very, very useful. And excuse this sort of slightly dodgy YouTube download. Hang on. That's Homer. You know him. Let's go next one. All right.
We could blow all our money on a stupid little street, but...
So the EPA have been fined for dumping nuclear waste in the city park. There's a town meeting being declared, and they're about to do Main Street. And then along comes
Scott. You know, a town with money is a little like the mule with a spinning wheel. No one knows how he got it, and dang if he knows how to use it. Mule. The name's Landley, Lyle Landley. And I come before you good people tonight with an idea. Probably the greatest... Oh, it's not for you. It's more of a Shelbyville idea.
Now, wait just a minute. We're twice as smart as the people of Shelbyville. Just tell us your idea and we'll vote for it.
All right. I tell you what I'll do. I'll show you my idea. I give you the Springfield Monorail. I've sold monorails to Brockway, Ogdenville, and North Haverbrook, and by gum, it put them on the map. Well, sir, there's nothing on earth like a genuine, bona fide, electrified six-car monorail. What did I say?
Monorail.
What's it called?
Monorail.
That's right, monorail.
I hear those things are awfully loud.
It flies as softly as a cloud. Is there a chance the trap could bend? Not on your life, my Hindu friend.
What about us Brendan slobs?
You'll be given cushy jobs.
Were you sent here by the devil?
No, good sir, I'm on the level.
The ring came off my pudding can.
Take my penknife, my good man. I swear it's Springfield's only choice. Throw up your hands and raise your voice. What's it called? Once again.
On Main Street, the law cracked and broken.
Sorry, Mom, the mom has spoken.
So every time you read a Tizer editorial about this grand vision, just think monorail. Because I've even had conversations with people that actually I like and respect and are very wise, but they say, we've got to grab this before WA or New South Wales grabs this, or Shelbyville. So there is this grand plan being talked about amongst political circles. We accept the waste first, then we use the billions to fund the creation of these nuclear power plants, and there's all these wonderful aspects to it which have been talked about. We get all this waste for free. In fact, they give it to us and they pay us to take it, and then we get free power. It is I feel like Lyle Landley talking right now. But as Scott said, the real game is the dumping, and the rest seems to be all this myth, and it's so unrealistic in a state which has such a high penetration of renewables and can do it so well. So what can we do? Well, I have to refer now to the other expert here, Lisa Simpson, for this one.
We could blow all our money and...
Go next one. Okay.
Come gather round, children, it's high time you learned about a hero named Homer and a devil named Burns. We'll march till we drop, the girls and the fellas. We'll fight till the death or else fold like umbrellas. So we'll march day and night by the big cooling tower. They have the plans, but we have the power.
So, in terms of what's next, I think we do have the power. And we've already seen it in terms of the change in terms of reference. When they first came out, they were appalling. I mean, there's still the massive gap of the mining, but through the work of the groups and the individuals who have put in submissions and have lobbied and done the media work, there's been some significant changes which have improved them and actually helps a much better conversation. And I think we mustn't forget that we're acting from a position of strength. We shouldn't imagine ourselves being on the margins. There's an overwhelming public opposition to nuclear waste. And we mustn't forget that. I think it's so easy for us to sort of read the advertiser or see the TV and think that we're somehow the outsider voice. We're not. We're the mainstream voice, and we mustn't forget that. Secondly, I think the Commission is a real opportunity. Scott's talked in the media about putting the nuclear industry on trial. It's an opportunity to ask some of these questions, and with the change in the terms of reference, we actually can ask some real questions. And ask powerful questions like, exactly about the one around, if it is such an economic bonanza, why is every other country so desperate to get rid of this stuff? Also, I think we mustn't forget this is a marathon, not a sprint. It's a long-term journey. This is an 18-month journey. It's so easy for us to burn out in campaigns such as this when it's so emotional. We need to be smart and strategic with our engagement. There's a lot of conversations going on amongst the groups, mine, Conservation Council, ACF, Friends of the Earth, amongst various traditional owners, trying to work out how we actually can be as strategic as possible. And I really would encourage you, if you're concerned about this issue, to get involved. There will be some lists afterwards to put your name down, and also out the front there's the NAPA people down in Port Adelaide. There are some great people involved. Also, we need the next generation of voices to speak, and there's a whole lot of things we can learn from Lock the Gate movement around having lots and lots of people involved rather than just having a few key spokespeople, and particularly in the areas of tourism and health and economics, not just environmental voices. And we need to really talk up the alternative, and that is renewables. And also our other economic stories. We've got some fantastic stories here in South Australia about we actually don't need this. We don't need this. So we've got to actually tell those stories and really, we're better than this. And just like to, I know my time's short. So to finish on a bit of a note of caution. What I don't want is a split emerging in a very small movement. And this has a bit of a danger of that. There are people who I like and respect who are very worried about climate change and want to see some action and they're desperate to reach out to nuclear as a solution. We mustn't lose contact with those people because we need every single person concerned about climate change active and connected. So it's a bit of a call that we've already so few with. We've got to stick together. And that, as the state's peak environment body, that's one of my jobs, I think, is to really try and make sure that we don't have this split emerging. So thank you, and remember, we have the power.
Having grown up knowing her father's story and his struggles with the nuclear tests that took place in the 1950s at Maralinga and how they've impacted him and his family, Karina is understandably apprehensive about the Royal Commission into the nuclear fuel cycle here in South Australia. Karina has a long family connection with anti-nuclear activism. Her grandmother, Eileen Kumpakuta Brown, was involved along with the Kupa Piti Kunga Chuta in a campaign known as Irati Wanti, or the Poison Leave It campaign back in 1998. And this was a fight against a previous incarnation of the current plans for a nuclear waste dump proposal. Now, that struggle ended successfully in 2004 after nearly 10 years of campaigning. So in Karina Lester, we have the next generation taking on this struggle and speaking out strongly on how this nuclear industry has impacted on her family and her people. Please welcome Karina Lester.
Good evening, everybody. Before I want to continue on, I do want to acknowledge that I am on Kaurna country and pay my respects because I'm a young Aṉangu woman and I come from the Adelaide Yankunytjatjara lands, so I'm a visitor to this country, so I want to acknowledge the Kaurna people. I want to also acknowledge my older Gungurl, my older sister, who's here also, and other Aboriginal people that are in this room, but also all you great greenies, or Greenytjatjara, as my grandmother spoken very often to me, Greenytjatjara, and acknowledge all the great work that you've done. My presentation is really talking about recapping that kind of family history within my own family, and talk about Irrawaddy, the poison, leave it, and Bumbunduwiya, don't touch it, and that's what the old women spoke very strongly about as well. I know I'm on a little bit of a time limit, but I also will be just sort of recapping some of Dad's journey over in the Royal Commission into those tests that happened in the 50s, and his recollection of Maralinga and what happened. Also talk about Nana Gombora's journey, I guess, with the Kumbiri Gungajuda as well, and talk a little bit about that fight and that struggle. But also about the Makati crew as well, because soon after leaving us in South Australia, they jumped the border and went over to the territory. And also talk about this Royal Commission and I guess our next journey forward as well, taking it on. Of course, Maralinga was the day the ground shook and the black mist rolled. Dad was sitting on the veranda, I guess, at the time, or heard it on the radio anyway, that's for sure. When people were sort of getting that wrong information across about how information was relayed about this test and how people were informed and engaged, and how Aranoko were told about these tests to take place in the 50s. Dad remembers that very strongly. He must have been an ex-service person that was talking on the radio on ABC, and Dad was quite strong to speak up strongly about that and say no, that wasn't the case. He didn't come out there, he didn't come and speak with Aranoko. He didn't engage with us, he didn't consult with us to let us know that they're about to, you know, release some amazing power out there at Maralinga and have a little bit of a play around, I guess, on, you know, when we later found out after 50 years there was a number of tests that took place out there at Maralinga. And so that was his journey. He remembers that day when that black mist rolled and the ground shook, how people, my grandparents at the time, where Dad is retired and living there at Wallatina, that was the location just behind the homestead over near the sand dune is where the location of where people saw this black mist roll and experienced that ground shaking and the fear that came across everybody as well. I'm very concerned about where to, what do we do, how do we explain this? You know, dust storms come with noise and they bring wind and they, you know, at least warn us, but this was a silent mist of black smoke that rolled across the country. And people were very fearful, and Dad, I guess, started that journey to talk about that wasn't the case of talking to us and letting us know that this was going to happen. So he spoke very strongly, and of course got support from a lot of other Aranoko people along the way, and people who remembered that story and remembered that particular day and shared their stories. And obviously Dad went away, I was a young girl when Dad went away over to do the Royal Commission into Maralinga and those tests that happened as well. Photo of my grandmother, Nana Benge, on the left hand side, and Jamal Gunji, and one of the commissioners up there as well, talking about their story and about their experience. Nana Gumbawada on the right as well, standing up very strong and talking up very strong about her experience of Maralinga. And these people are people who have experienced what happened that day and how it's impacted. Dad has always been blind since growing up. I've always known Dad as being blind. He knows me by voice. He knows me by feeling me, my crazy hair, or you know how tall I'm growing. And that's how it's been all these years. And there are grandchildren, and there are great-grannies as well. And so his understanding of us is only through our voice and through feeling as well. And so that was a real big journey. I was probably, goodness me, less than 10 when Dad did the Royal Commission into those tests. And it was a challenge because both Mum and him and their lawyers went across over to London, so I was left back in Alice Springs, and my siblings were there with me, of course, and you know, we often saw them on TV. It's like, oh, Dad's on the news. So it was a big step and a big, I guess, in Dad's story, it was a opening of a lot of can of worms there that talked about a lot of things. He talked about, on behalf of Ranawadrida, and the impact it had on our mob. He also, you know, spoke about those concerns of those ex-servicemen as well, and you know, how I guess they got the bad end of the, or perhaps drawed that short straw to be involved in such a time in those 50s when those tests were taking place. As mentioned, you know, the Wandi campaign was huge for us when the test came past, when they wanted to propose a nuclear waste dump. These old women, and I apologise, I want to let you know that there are people who have passed on in my slides, so this is where I get my strength from, these wonderful women who have spoken up very strongly about water and how important country is. And, you know, it is not that empty space on country. It's full of so many stories. It's full of our waba, our ancestral stories. It's full of our jugwaba, all those really important stories. It's full of things that we live on and what we need to survive on as well. And that's where they came from, very strongly on the Irere Wandi campaign. These women spoke very strongly about those important stories, Seven Sister stories, and talked about how important that is, that it was their responsibility to pass this knowledge and information to the next line of generation. And it was the next line of generation to pass it on to the next line of generation. Our history is an oral history. Gumindjana spoke to me often about that, needing to transfer that knowledge as well. They rallied, they protested, they got out there, they marched those streets, those old women. Nana didn't fly over, she didn't do a lot of flying. So a lot of the women, a lot of the girls, the Melbourne Goongas, and Nina Brown and the Claire Browns and all those wonderful Griffith drove these wonderful women across this country to really get the message out about Irere Wandi, this poison, leave it. Nana was acknowledged, Nana Gambora was acknowledged for her great work that she's done in being awarded part of a recipient for the Goldman Prize with the late Eileen Wingfield, who is there on the left photo on the right, second to the on the right-hand side. And Nana Gambora, of course, we all flew and drove and made our way across to Sydney for Nana to get this award as well. And so all that whole journey of them campaigning against this as well was a lot of time and a lot of energy, but the women had that strength behind them because of the great knowledge that they have of their waba, their in stories, their very important stories of country, but also that knowledge of, you know, the need to protect our next line of generation as well. And of course, 2004, we were winners, and we have a premier at the time, then Mike Brown as well, who made it up there to meet those Goombas at there. And it was a big, big sigh of relief, you know, that time when it was all official that we had won this battle. But it was a long, long time over those years. A lot of protesting, a lot of campaigning, a lot of going out there and talking straight about a lot of things. But soon after winning here in South Australia, it obviously went over to the border to Makari and to the Northern Territory as well. And again, the same story. This knowledge, these Aranawa women and these Aboriginal women, Warramunga people from up that way there in the Northern Territory, Tennant Creek area, have the same knowledge, this knowledge of country, these stories that are so important to country. That knowledge is passed on to generations and generations. And so, you know, this was their next struggle. None of them had gone across to meet with them and to talk to them about their fight at Bilikalina and the whole Irere Wandi campaign. They shared their stories with these women as well. And of course, women took this struggle on and led the way in campaigning strongly, singing their songs, speaking up strongly, and being leaders within their communities, and again, getting that wonderful support by all these wonderful Griffith that are out there who help us in this journey. And we as Aboriginal people wouldn't have got to where we are in campaigning against this without these wonderful people that are out there who join in solidarity that we get together to fight these huge issues, because we're a small group of people, Aotearoa and Aboriginal people of this country, that we need all the support that we can get. And of course, their successful journey ending in 2014 as well, and winners again as well. So, you know, we need to learn from these stories. We need to bring those stories. We need to learn from my dad about, you know, how it's impacted, the sight that was taken away from him, and how every day I live with the fact that dad never sees me, and I've got children. I'm a mother of four, and, you know, he's never seen my children. Now, these are real stories. These are heart stories. We need to take on those journeys from those old women, Nananjana, Kamburanjana, who led that way in that campaign against that waste dump, because they were not going to have a bar of it. They often said, government, you're a binabadi, you're a binayaji. They often said that, like, government, where are your ears? Why are you not listening to us who have this great knowledge of this country and have a responsibility? This is a cultural responsibility of keeping our stories, sharing our stories, and working together to protect our country as well. We need to really learn from these messages. The success of the Irariwandi campaign, the success of the Makari campaign as well. I'm fearful of it being generational. You know, why is this being discussed again? When just over 10 years ago, you know, we went through that trauma. It's become a generational trauma for my family. Dad, Nana Gambora, myself, living with it every day. My youngest son, William, is it a battle for him that he needs to take on and fight this fight of his jamu or his bibis, his ondaruda, his daughters in our kinship structure? Family is so important, generation to generation. You know, is this another battle that we have to continue on? Is it generational? Our jorba, our wabara, our country isn't for sale. So the amount of dollars and billions or whatever you people are dangling is no value to that knowledge that these old people have, and the knowledge of transferring that knowledge down. We're still very lucky to have our country and our connect to our country. We're still very lucky to have our wanga, our language as well. And so I worry about those things. I worry about that transfer of the, you know, the future generation. And that's my crew on the right, on the left-hand side slide there. And this is the great granny of Yami Lester, with the dark hair as well. You know, this is not a matter that should be left for our children to have to deal with. This is a struggle for us every day. And I guess having that experience and learning from Nananjana, I think we need to bring those stories together and get it out there to talk openly about these stories. But of course, do it safely within and around great support that's out there. And I call on every one of you to join with the Aboriginal community. I'm doing some quiet work myself in trying to bring the rally and the support with the Aboriginal groups. So speaking with Bugada people, speaking with Anangarangamurra Yankunytjatjara people, speaking with my own mob or the Yankunytjatjara and Biyanjara mob, also speaking with Maralinga Jaraja mob, and starting to at least try and have that dialogue with them. One thing I noticed that as this whole thing was announced, Aṉangu were left behind. We're dealing with a lot of things in remote communities. And so, you know, we've been struggling about the fear of perhaps getting removed off our communities as well. Not knowing, people are struggling day to day in those remote communities. So this announcement would have not reached that community north of Port Augusta, east or west. And so that was one of the big issues and concerns that I've had. And I've expressed it as well to say, Aṉangu are not being engaged. You are not bringing us on this journey. You are not informing us. And if you're going to start informing us, you need to use Aṉangu interpreters. You need to be engaging with us openly and transparently. These are words that often get flown around all the time, but they need to be sitting down with us on country. And so I've pushed strongly to make sure that parts of this Royal Commission is out on country as well, and that we actually sit down with the people who have got a story to share, a story to tell about how tests have impacted on their family, and the risks and the, you know, and their cultural roles and responsibilities as well, to pass on those knowledge of that country, of our Jugurba, of our Waba, which are our real important stories of this country that zigzag through not only in South Australia but right across this nation as well. So I'm trying to do the little work that I can do to try and engage with my animal community and Aboriginal people of this South Australia, but also calling on others to have, you know, stand with us and unite with us, because I know Nanagabawada mob wouldn't have been able to do it without the beautiful Griffith, and I know the Makati mob wouldn't have been able to do it without those wonderful people out there as well, Griffith. So I really thank you all for all that support, for standing with us and letting us be there to, you know, speak up strong about this. And I want to end by Nana's hand there saying Irariwandi. Irariwandi.
Karina, and that, it's just fantastic, because we're looking at this at so many levels. There's, you know, an economic and an intellectual level, and there's the human level. So thank you for sharing that with us. We're going to now have a quick Q&A. I didn't have the heart to cut anyone short tonight. It was just so fantastic. But if I could ask the four of you to just come up to the front here. And we've got time for a few questions before the good folk at the Mercury get the vacuum cleaner out and ask us if we haven't got homes to go to. Now, we've only got the one roving microphone, which Sam has, and so we're going to have to swap around, and I'll look over this side first for a question. Yeah, Claire. And just wait till the microphone reaches you, because we're recording.
Hi, thank you very much for very interesting presentations. I'd just like to, I was involved in the Makati case from the beginning. I've also had a long involvement in anti-nuclear work. I just want to clarify in my mind what some issues might be, because I honestly don't know. The first is that in relation to nuclear waste dump, there seems to be three potential sources of material that you dump. The first is nuclear waste medicine. And I'm wondering what the panel thinks we ought to be doing about that unavoidable nuclear waste that we have in the country. The second is this philosophy that if we mine the uranium from Australia, we have some responsibility to take the waste. And the third is, of course, this plan or this prospect that we become the empty country you can dump things in. So from my perspective, I think people sometimes get confused in relation to what the nuclear waste dump is. And the Mukherjee case wasn't necessarily about dump or no dump. It was about the fact that there was a failure to consult with the traditional owners, the real people who should have been consulted with. And I spoke to some of the Indigenous people who were complaining about that dump, and they said, this money should be coming to me. This is my money. This is my land. I want it. And so it's not quite so clear that if you actually have proper consultation with an Indigenous community, you'll end up with no dump. You might end up with a dump. And then you decide, well, should we have a dump or not? So I think sometimes it can be very confusing for the community at large to know where they should stand in their heart if they're opposed to nuclear waste. And in particular, this issue of what is sitting in Lucas Heights at the moment, and that is nuclear waste from medicine. And what should we be doing about that?
Thanks for the question. I think the first issue, the waste from medical isotopes and other nuclear processing, industrial use, for example, in Australia, we have a clear responsibility to deal with that. I was involved in advising the inquiry into the first proposal for one in South Australia, and I said that there should be at least a back-of-the-envelope risk calculation to work out the comparative risk to the community of storing the waste where it is now compared with transporting it to a well-engineered site somewhere where there's agreement to host it. And I said that that's absolutely essential. I think it's morally scandalous that we say to some Indigenous communities, you can only have the things that every Australian is entitled to expect if you accept industries that no other Australian community would accept. That was used at James Price, it was used at Muckaty, it was used in South Australia. I think that's morally reprehensible. I think there probably is a case for there to be a well-engineered waste repository somewhere in Australia, not necessarily on Indigenous land, but it should be somewhere where the community is happy to have it there, provided it's clear that that minimises the risk. And I think the second issue is whether we are morally responsible for uranium having mined it. And I think the answer is yes, but that suggests to me that we shouldn't be mining it and exporting it. Because the Fox report said in 1976, if we mine and export uranium, we are responsible for the fact that that produces radioactive waste, and it produces fissile material that can be turned into weapons, and it produces fissile material that can fuel reactors that can be subject to accidents. And they said that we should only export uranium if we're prepared to live with those consequences. Now, I don't think those consequences are acceptable, and the argument that we should do it because of the money, I think, is bizarre, because as an export industry, nuclear ranks with tin. We make more money exporting cheese than we do exporting uranium. And given that radioactive waste is more unsavory than an old Gorgonzola, and the non-proliferation agreement has more holes than a Swiss cheese, I think we should be exporting cheese rather than exporting uranium.
Okay, now down in the front, Sam. The chap there at the black. Just leave it turned on.
It'll just stay on. Hi, it's not so much a question. I've travelled a long way. I'd just like to make a comment. I am skin son to Bunny Nabarula from the Muckaty Mob. And by your good grace, the Lesters, I work in partnership with them, and I'd like to thank the traditional owners for the opportunity to be here. I recently worked with Jeffrey Lee, the gentleman that Scott Ludlam spoke about, who bequeathed his land to the Kakadu National Park to protect it from uranium mining. I'm going to break my contract to do with that documentary, but I'm not going to give specifics. There's a documentary coming out that tells his story, and I can't speak to that story, but what I can speak to is the relationship that Aboriginal people have with the land. And what happened post-Fukushima was those groups, those tribes, those clans, those people where uranium was mined, they went into sorry business. They grieved for the loss that is due to the Fukushima crisis. That happened because of the creation story that's going to be revealed in this documentary. That basically we've been waiting for white fella science to catch up to our knowledge systems. There were four warnings given by the old people from those from country about this disaster, about the potential for disaster, about this poison. And they were given last century. And that story will be told in this documentary. Now this is not an abstract concept. This is an emotional, spiritual, psychological condition that Aboriginal people experience due to this issue. It is grief. And I have sat with Aboriginal people of this land impacted by this issue, besides being impoverished due to the failure of policy, besides not having a seat at the table in terms of policy about the issues that affect them. On top of this, they are in grief. They are physically, holistically suffering due to this issue on a daily basis. And that is happening now. This is a human story. And I just want to make that point. Now, Jeffrey Lee will tell this creation story in the documentary. It will be out in August via SBS and PBS. And you will see this. And you will see Aboriginal knowledge systems contain the knowledge that you are seeking to move your societies forward. And I just want to reiterate what Scott said about the potential for renewable energy. That energy has the potential to work in partnership with our culture, with our knowledge systems to sustain them, and to take us all forward into the future, sustainably. like the work of Uncle Kurt Buzzacott. And his tireless work with this issue, and I just want to honour him, and I'm sorry that he couldn't be here this evening. And one more thing, if I may. If you have the capacity to bring Aboriginal people to this campaign, could you please connect with the Greens and NALPA and help us? We just don't have the resources. We're now trying to strategise, how do we get out to country? How do we engage? We need help with that. And I'm actually begging, I will beg you, to help us with resources and help us strategise for that purpose. I went to a council meeting yesterday. I was the only Aboriginal person in the room and I had to travel interstate to be at that meeting. That's the reality for us. So please help us and get in touch with NALPA and the Greens to help us with capacity building. Thank you.
So my question is partly to Karen, and sorry I didn't catch the gentleman's name who was speaking just before. Adam, was it? My question is, can you give us some very real and practical ways that we can help in terms of getting a campaign up and running? Because I've also heard, you also mentioned that it's really important that we get a campaign up and that we don't have a split within that campaign, because we are, relatively speaking, such a small group. How can we move forward? What steps can we take? What practical ways can we change the future, create the future that we want that doesn't include nuclear?
Well, I think just pick up from what Adam was saying, he's pointed us in the direction of the Greens and also with NALPA as well. I think at one point, I want to say this, it's our normal business as well at the same time, so I think we need to group ourselves together and one-on-one, Aranongurda, sit down and have this conversation ourselves as well to really talk about where are we going, and with this information, what do we want to do, how are we going to want to lead this as well, and then where do we need to get those supports as well from the Green Indigenous that are out there, you know, and working with great organisations like the Fund Council and the Conservation Foundation as well, and lots of people. There's a lot of people out there who've helped us over the many, many decades now, and I think we need to work slowly on that. There are organisations as well. I think my older sister's involved in, is it ANFA? So you've got the Alliance crew that's also there as well. We need to, again, these organisations, you know, run almost on the smell of a dirty rag, so, you know, we really need to try and get the support and the best support that we can. And I think the start is the fundraising kind of stuff, you know, how do we get these big groups together? I've been trying to rack my brain on how to get our animal groups together, and we need to travel from a long way, and where's the best location, and how do we group ourselves? This all, you know, obviously adds up in getting a group of people down to talk up and you know, express their concerns as well. So, you know, fundraising is definitely one area. Is there some way that we can sort of look into raising some funds to get groups together? Us as Aboriginal people taking on that responsibility of working and grouping ourselves together. The vision is starting to occur, and we're seeing out there in the media that some people are kind of leaning on that side. And you know, the lady's comment about Makati, and people were saying, well, that's money to me because it's on my munda. This is what this carrot does to our mob. That's how it works. They split us and they divide us, and then they set us on one another. And that's the thing I'm really, really fearful of. I'm really concerned, and I really need to think strategically, work with my older sister, work with my people, work with Adam that's here as well, to sort of work and strategize, how do we stop this division from happening, and how do we nip that one in the bud very quickly, because that doesn't need to happen. We need to think very carefully about this and how we can do that as well. So that's just a comment that I wanted to make. Adam might have something else to say.
Actually, what we might do, Craig wants to just quickly respond. And Beck, can you pass that microphone forward to this gentleman so that we can keep moving? And we might have to make this just about the last question, I think.
Yeah, there was an initial flurry of activity around the terms of reference. There was an opportunity to actually influence those. And so a lot of people went into sort of full-on campaign mode initially to try and change those terms of reference. Now that they're out, the Commission is now starting its work. That's, as I said in my presentation, now we move from that sort of sprint time into more of a marathon. And there is a lot of thinking and planning going on around how we actually do that wisely. My sense is that it is a different conversation in South Australia this time, and we need to actually do it carefully. There will be some clipboards at the end. As the Conservation Council, we've tended to be a bit of a gathering point and a bit of a lightning rod for people who are keen to get involved. And we're very keen to sort of pass on people who are keen to get involved but not quite sure how. There are a range of different people right through from the activists through to the more formal research end of this work. And we're very happy to sort of point people in the right direction. So please put your name down and we can send you in the right direction.
Thanks, Craig. And if the clipboard is still stopped somewhere, keep it circulating because it was going around the room.
Mark, can I just make one quick comment? I think it is important to campaign against proposals for building nuclear power stations. But I think if you go to politicians trying to stop a proposal that they think is bringing jobs and money into the state, you need to be going to them with proposals that will bring jobs and money into the state. So I think you should be actively campaigning for renewable energy in South Australia to be the renewable energy capital of the world. And that makes sense because there are far more jobs in 100% renewable energy than in one crummy little waste dump.
I'm told that we live in a democracy. And I'm also told, I believe this part, that most people are opposed to nuclear energy in Australia, and in particular the waste dump. So why has the government even considered this proposal? Can anyone enlighten me on this?
I can have a quick go. I think South Australia is a little... Do we need to watch the Simpsons video again? The monorail effect. The SA political culture seems like a bit of a closed shop in the sense, and I think actually BHP is a huge part of that. Like having a state with a perilously narrow economic base so dominated by a single operator, I firmly believe is actually poison the politics, and that these people are true believers. They don't get up in the morning wanting to contaminate the human gene line for the rest of eternity. They actually believe the spin from the 1950s, the too cheap to meter stuff. They genuinely believe it. So the people, because I know there's I think it's Uni of SA, there's kind of a small cohort, the kind of Barry Brooks cohort. Like Uni of SA, sorry, where am I? You probably, half the room's probably heard of Barry Brooks, who are coming at this from the George Monbiot perspective of, if you really understood climate change, then every option is on the table. No matter how reckless it sounds, climate change is that serious. And I figure like with that cohort, you can kind of meet them halfway and go, I agree with your concern and totally disagree with that particular conclusion that you've drawn. But I think we actually do have to take a little step back and try and understand the psychology of people. That I can get. A lot of it, quite frankly, is just craven crony capitalism. There are people who just want to pour concrete. I don't care what they're pouring concrete for. There's a lot of concrete poured for nuclear power plants, you know, and some of it's just that basic and simple. And I strongly agree with the conception that we've got to come back with better counter-arguments and not green jobs, actual jobs. And that also includes fundamentally economic sustainability and self-sufficiency for Aboriginal communities. We cannot walk away from people who, you know, like quite addicted to diesel, some of these communities spending an utter fortune generating expensive electricity. And are now threatened to be dispossessed because in WA and South Australia, the government's proposing to pull the plug. And we can't leave that mob out there to fend for themselves. Only politically vulnerable because the alternatives haven't actually been put forward. I feel like collectively that's as much of our job as putting the hand up and stopping the bad stuff.
I'm just going to call on Senator Penny Wright to propose a vote of thanks for our four speakers, and we'll finish up shortly.
Thanks, Mark.
Yes, it is my privilege to propose a vote of thanks tonight, and I think you'll agree with me that we've heard four consummate communicators tonight. It's been really interesting to see the length of time and the amount of experience that we've had in the room, and looking around the audience here too, I can see that many people here have been working on these issues for far too long. As Mark said, you keep thinking that you're going to win these battles, and we realise we actually just have to stay eternally vigilant. So we've heard the economic, we've heard the scientific, and I think particularly moving was hearing from Karina about the absolutely fundamental human aspects of this technology. Like many people here, I've also, we've all worked on these issues for a long time. I was a Cold War teenager, and when I was a young lawyer in Ballarat, I joined an organisation which had a very apt acronym. It was the Ballarat Anti-Nuclear Group. I think one of the things that I've struck tonight, is that this, in some ways, I wasn't expecting such a serious issue to be so funny. And that's part of the great communications we've heard tonight. I think that actually underlines just how ludicrous it is, the proposal that's being put to us. But would you please join me in thanking... Senator Scott Ludlam, Craig Wilkins, and Karina Lester.